and the door will open. Seek and you will find. Ask and you'll be given the key to this world of mine. I'll be waiting here with my arms unfurled, waiting just for you.
I consider it a compliment to have been asked to chair the bank. I think it has given me a lot of experience, and it has allowed me to participate in something meaningful in the annals of Nevis. I am thankful for him for having asked me.
As we continue our series of interviews under the caption Sim Remembered, we have as our very special guest this evening Mr. Hanzel Manners, accountant, retired banker, who found himself in on the ground floor of the Bank of Nevis, established in 1985. I've got a copy of Washington Archibald's book, The Legacy of Dr. SIEON DANIEL. And on page 138, it says the establishment of the Bank of Nevis was a major feat in Daniel's administration. And then on page 139, it says, when he had finally garnered a satisfactory fund of support, he invited Richard Lupinacci, a small hotel operator and former banker, to manage the bank. One Sunday, out of the blue, as Nevisian Hanzel Manners recalls, he received a call from Sim Daniel inviting him to fill the position of chairman of the board of directors. Hanzel, tell us about that out of the blue call from SIEON DANIEL, the late SIEON DANIEL, to be first chairman of the board of directors of the Bank of Nevis.
Yes, Steve, as you indicated, it was out of the blue. I didn't expect it. As you know, at the time I was living in St. Kitts, I was at the time employed at TDC as chief accountant at TDC, and I heard all the talk about a bank being formed in Nevis and directors being put together and capital being raised, but I was not at that time involved in that process in any meaningful way. So it was a surprise to me when I got that call on a Sunday afternoon asking me whether I would consider taking on the role as chairman. I have not found out, well, I can only surmise as to the reason why he called. I think he knew I was a Nevisian. I had recently qualified as an accountant, and I think generally the feeling was that as an accountant, you would know something about business. And I believe that was why the call came to me. I would say now, after 30 years, that I didn't know very much about banking. But I accepted the call, and I sometimes like to joke about that, because at the time, and it was away in Jamaica at the university, and the call came on a Sunday afternoon, and I didn't consult her. I didn't consult her. I simply thought it over quickly, and I said, yes, I'll give it a shot. And I'll be honest in saying that several times after, I sometimes thought I had made an error by accepting without consulting, because there were times when the bank had difficulties, and I said to myself, boy, what trouble did I get myself in? But at the end of it all, I am glad that I answered the call and I participated in something that for Nevisians has become something significant and big. So I thank him for calling me. At that time, as far as I know, a lot of the groundwork had been done in terms of raising capital, in terms of getting directors together. And I think he was simply looking for somebody to fill the role of chairman. I think other people had been asked and maybe had said no. And so he was on the hunt for somebody to be the chairman. And I said yes.
In reading his book, and I read it over the weekend for the third time, He seemed to have a knack for picking people. We've heard about Mr. Augustine Merchant, who Mr. Archibald said had played a fine innings for Nevis, which Sim watched, and went all the way to Fort O'Gills to get him to help in his land reform. Don't you think it was something about you that he had seen? Maybe your professional integrity, your work ethics, which made him think that you'd be a good fit to be on the ground floor of this indigenous bank?
Well, it is not for me to say or to boast about. That's the first thing I need to say. But secretly, I think it was a compliment to be asked to be the chairman of a bank. That at that time, starting a bank in a place like Nevis was not a popular thing. As a matter of fact, it was frightening. The experience was somewhat frightening because, as we all know, the Bank of Commerce had failed and people had lost their money. And there was a lot of talk about this new bank, and Mr. Daniel, I think, was very brave to go forward with this idea. So, in a way, I consider it a compliment to have been asked to chair the bank. I think it has given me a lot of experience, and it has allowed me to participate in something meaningful in the annals of Nevis. And so, after all the years, after having swayed during the years, I am thankful for him for having asked me.
Now let's go back to the book again, because those were very heady days.
Before you go to the book, could I just say something about Mr. Daniel that I had intended to start with? Because my first recollection or in involvement with Mr. Daniel involved two different things. When Mr. Daniel came back to Nevis, I don't know the exact dates, but at the time he had set up his offices in Nevis, I was just out of university, and having worked in St. Kitts at the Basti High School for 2 years, I came back to Nevis in 1974, and that is when I got married. And Mr. Daniel was a young attorney at that time. My first involvement with him was going to his offices to borrow a book. I had just started to get involved in my business studies. I was still a teacher, and I was doing some work on contract law, and I didn't have any books. And I remember one day I walked up to his office. His office was then at the top of Slack's liquor store. And I went up to his office, and I discussed it with him, and I told him, did he have anything for me I could read? And he offered me 3 books. I'll be honest with you, I don't think I returned them. He maybe gave them to me. But he just looked on his shelf and pulled off a book on contract law and gave it to me. So that says a lot about him to me, because he was not the type to say, don't disturb me, you can't have my books. He readily pulled his books from his shelf and gave them to me. So he has helped me somewhat in his studies. The other thing I remember about him too is that he was always interested in Nevisians buying a piece of land. And he always said that, boy, the land is there, buy the land. So my very first piece of land, I bought from Mr. Daniel at Ramsbury. And so I remember those two things, his love, his passion for seeing Nevisians own a piece of land. And his passion is in seeing Nevisians study and qualify. I thought I needed to say that.
Let's get back to the book then. It says on page 138, when he was inspired by the vision to establish the Bank of Nevis, the Bank of Commerce, and you referred to that earlier, based in St. Kitts and managed by fellow Nevisian Eugene Walwyn, had recently collapsed. This event did not help Premier Daniel as he approached his countrymen with the proposal to start a bank. Both local Nevisians regarded the proposal with skepticism. They pronounced the scheme stillborn. Others were cynical, openly declaring that the Premier was hatching a smart lawyer's plot to open a bank for his own benefit. They refused to invest in the enterprise. They referred to it as Sim's Bank. Do you think there were selfish motives, or was he being totally selfless?
Selfish motive on Sim's part, you mean?
Or was he selfless in putting something in place that would benefit all Nevisions, true to the motto, improving the quality of life?
Now, I think the answer to that has to be a firm no, that Mr. Daniel, in my opinion, was not selfish. As a matter of fact, he was exceedingly selfless, and his experience and the work put into the bank through that. Mr. Daniel had the vision of the bank, and as I said, a lot of his groundwork had been accomplished by the time I got there. But my experience is that he had a passion for things Nevisians. He had a passion for people, for Nevisian people. And he gave of himself to see these Nevisian things happen. He was not in it for money. And he was a politician, yes, but as I'm sure others have said, he was more in it for seeing Nevis advance. And that is what I remember of Mr. Daniel. I would like to give a little history of what went on when the bank was being formed. What I would say highlights the work that Mr. Daniel had put in. He's the one who floated the idea and who went around looking for participants, trying to raise capital. I have the prospectus, the first prospectus, that is the document that is prepared when an institution is going to go looking for shares. And I had a look at it today, and I was struck by the very first, the message inside the cover. It's a quote from Alexander Hamilton, dated 1781, and it says, "Most commercial nations have found it necessary to institute banks, and they have proved to be the happiest engines that ever were invented for advancing trade." And I think this was put here because this was the underpinning of Mr. Daniel's motivation for starting a bank, and he saw it as a vehicle for developing Nevis. He saw it as a vehicle where Nevisians at home and abroad can put their money in and assist with the development of Nevis, and at the same time earning a return on the investment. You mentioned that about the Bank of Commerce. It was not a happy time. It was not a happy time. And I don't want to speak for the other directors, but I'm sure a lot of us, even as we said yes and participated, were extremely worried, because it's not easy to start a new institution of any type, but it's a bank is a special type of institution, because a bank stock in trade is money. And if you have no money and people are afraid to put their money with you, then there are big problems. And so most of us entered with trepidation. And that is where SIM played a big part, because SIM was the confident one who felt that things would work. And while others who maybe looked more at the figures and said, boy, these are frightening times, he had that vision which pulled us all along. So the reaction of the people was understandable. Scotiabank had just started down the street a few months earlier. And so not only were people frightened about what had happened to Bank of Commerce, but they said, but Nevis is overbanked. Because you have so many, you have banks, and you have Scotia just came to Nevis, and he'd have another bank. So there was a lot of skepticism. Lots of skepticism.
And of course, there's always the thinking in these countries that a king, in this instance a bank, has no honor in his own country. We've been steeped on Barclays Bank and Scotia Bank, and banks which have come from or headquartered in big cities.
Yes, we had grown up on the foreign banks. And so an indigenous bank didn't have an easy time getting the trust of the people. And that is where I think the board had to play an important part of being people of integrity, for one, that people can trust, but also going out and comforting people and letting people know things are going to work. And that is what the board did in the early years. A few dates which might be interesting. The bank was incorporated in August 1985 and opened its doors in December, the 9th of December 1985. So the bank is now, how many years will that be? 27 years. And I had a look at the first prospectus attempted to raise $2 million in capital, 200,000 shares at $10 each. At the time the bank started, the capital of the bank, that is the amount of money that the bank had, was $250,000. Now the minimum capital for starting a bank according to the Banking Act at that time, which was the Banking Act of 1967, was $500,000. And I think, from what I remember, the governor of the central bank allowed the bank a little leeway, that was Mr. Jacobs, to start operations while it got the funds together. So there was some help given. But $250,000 to start a bank with is really not very much. Mr. Daniel had done a lot of the groundwork. He had traveled around, not only within Nevis, calling on people to put in a $25,000 here, and I've heard people like Mr. Brantley says he was one of the first to put in his money, and other people put in their monies. But he had traveled to
major cities.
Mm-hmm. He had sought the assistance of USAID and got a Barbadian banker, retired banker, Mr. Harold Russell, to come to Nevis to work for 3 months to put the systems and so in place. He's the one who helped to set up the bank. And he traveled to England and United Kingdom, as is said in the prospectus, to speak to Nevisians in those centers to ask them to put some money in the bank. But not only that, to get correspondent banks. In other words, a bank in Nevis cannot operate without a correspondent bank in London and United States. So all that kind of groundwork Mr. Daniel did in getting everything in place. He had to see about getting a building as well. As you know, the bank started on the same spot. Mm-hmm. Well, the spot it has just moved from, on rented premises. And the extent of the bank premises was the downstairs floor. I mean, the size of hardly bigger than one of the staff offices right now. But that was the extent, rented from, I think, the Archibald family. He had done a lot of groundwork in that kind of thing. So he had done all the work. All of the work. And I remember on the Saturday morning when the bank started, we had the public ceremony on a Saturday morning, and I came over from St. Kitts and made my speech as chairman. And I will be honest and tell you that when I looked at the crowd and saw how people were skeptical, I was a young accountant at the time, just having qualified 3 years before. And I was a bit shaken, because I felt deep down I had doubts about, in my own mind, whether this would really work. So in a way I was very brave, I must say, to take that that leap in the dark, because I thought it could have professional consequences for me. I was working somewhere else, I had just become an accountant. And at the end of the meeting, I was worried. I'll be honest. I don't think I was alone. We were uncertain, uncharted waters, would it work? Mm-hmm. But it's interesting to note that it has worked. It took a lot of work over the years. And I'd like to share something from my notes, because when Mr. Daniel went to in his attempt to raise capital, he relied on certain people overseas. And I have a list of people here I copied from the prospectus that he relied on, whose offices he pointed people to. In England, he called on the services of Mr. Desmond Herbert in Leeds to canvass Nevisians and to get them. And I think he did a good job at doing that. In the United States, in New York, he relied on Eustace Huggins. In Canada, Montreal, he had Mr. Reginald Cavaggio, who, you know, up to recently was a director of the bank. And he also called on Sinclair Walwyn, Mr. Walwyn from Bath Village, who has lived in Toronto for some time and who is now deceased. But his name is mentioned in the prospectus as somebody that the people in Toronto could call on to if they wanted to invest. And so Desmond Herbert, Eustace Huggins, and Reginald Cavaggio initially were directors of the bank, but Mr. Walwyn wasn't. The first meeting was held in October 1985. At that time, we used to have meetings at Penny's Beach Hotel on a Friday night. And so I had to come over from St. Kitts on a Friday night and catch a 6 o'clock boat, and then I went back on a Saturday morning. And we did that for several years. And sometimes we went on until 1 o'clock. And that is how it was in the early days.
A little known fact, it was Dick Lupinacci who contacted myself, mm-hmm. and Bernadette Maynard, who had 2 years before had been crowned Miss Independence, to voice mm-hmm. the first ad that uh-huh. was done on behalf of the Bank of Nevis. Now, you made reference to a statement by Alexander Hamilton mm-hmm. on the inside cover of the first prospectus.
Yes.
Alexander Hamilton, as we know, is an outstanding Nevisian who became First Secretary of the Treasury of the mighty United States. Did you get a sense then that Mr. Daniel saw him as a sort of guiding light, why he inserted that, or had that inserted in the prospectus?
He must have been inspired by the experience of Alexander Hamilton, that a lot of things relating to the American economy and were put in place by Alexander Hamilton, and he must have seen him as a model as he looked at Nevis, and the fact that Hamilton had been born in Nevis then added to that as well. So I think he saw him as a model, as how a nation should develop, because that's what the code says, that banks are critical to the development of a nation. And so he saw the Bank of Nevis as an important vehicle for the development of Nevis. I think he saw that if Nevis were to get anywhere, Nevis needs to have his own bank, so they wouldn't have to go running around relying on everybody. That was the idea. But I must also say that the Bank of Nevis, people said it was Sims Bank, and it was a political bank, and it was an NRP bank, and all that kind of stuff. And all that caused some problems and worry. But it was none of the sort. It was genuinely a Nevisian bank. Sim just happened to have been a politician, and I don't think he was the type who put his politics aside. He was more pro-Nevis than pro-politics. That was my experience. And so he saw it as a Nevisian vehicle for development of the island of Nevis. He didn't see Nevis going very far without having its own institution in the hands of Nevisians. The prospectus gave the reasons why capital was being sought, and it mentioned three things: to increase the capital of the bank, to provide security for its depositors, that is to make the bank safer, and secondly, and very importantly, to allow customers to buy land and build homes. So that was very much in his mind, to allow Nevisians to buy land and build homes. And thirdly, to finance new businesses. And the last part is extremely critical. To finance new businesses, particularly those that would cause job creation.
Very, very laudable objectives. Yeah. My history professor at college told me that economics is far more important than politics. Mm-hmm. And we can see the vision expressed by Dr. Daniel here. Sometimes I get the impression in modern day Nevis that we're so overtaken by politics that people don't quite understand that if you are to command the heights of your economy, that the economics are important.
I very much agree with that. I always say we can argue and talk about politics, but unless we learn to work, to save, to have some money, we'll always be talking and fighting with other people. The secret, not only for a country, but for a person, is to be economically and financially strong. Then you can stand on your own feet. So I don't think Mr. Daniel favored people who talked a lot, but didn't want to put in the work to get something and put their money where their mouth is. That is the secret. Put your money where your mouth is. You love Nevis? Put some money. Let us get it to work. So I agree a lot that politics is about... It's important because we must have leaders. But I think sometimes, like I say, we miss the message that you can't spend all day arguing about who have house and who have big house and who have big car and who build a big house. This message is go get a house. Go get one for yourself. That's my thing. Otherwise, you'll always be arguing about how this fella drives a big car and somebody builds a big house. Well, you have none.
So in the early days, there was Dick Lupinacci.
Yes.
There was
the board.
Julian Nisbet. You mentioned already some members of the board. And tell us a bit about the staff in the early days.
When the bank started, it had a staff of five. Five. My first manager was Mr. Lupinacci. And as you know, he was running a hotel at the time. So I think he made a big sacrifice to try to run a bank and a hotel at the same time. The accountant was Mr. Julian Nisbet, and I think there were three other young ladies at the time. Jasmine Daniel, Miss Williams, Teach Williams' daughter, she was in the early years. And of the current staff, I think Pat might have been the earliest one. Maybe not at the beginning, but she was one of the earliest ones. She had been there for quite a few years. So a staff of five, lots of work to do, so everybody had to double up. And we depended a lot on Julian as the accountant at that time. As time went on, the bank grew. And I think it was about 1 to 2 years after the bank bought the premises and was able to expand it to fix the upstairs. And so there was a boardroom upstairs, and the rooms were fixed up. And so we were able to move from Pinnis, where we had meetings, and to have the meetings at the bank. And from then on, the bank just grew and grew. This just started with five. I don't know the exact complement at this moment, but at one time, the bank had a staff of 61, 62, somewhere around there. 61, 62, that's a significant point to mention, and I think Sim has to, when you look at what he created, the vision he had, and to see the problems, initial problems, and the staff of five, now 61, many of whom, a large percentage of whom, are people with degrees, you know. I think the Bank of Nevis maybe is one of the biggest employers in Charlestown right now, in Nevis. I mean, if you leave out Four Seasons and qualified staff, qualified bankers, qualified this, qualified that. Take a check and you'll see. Very significant part that the bank has played in the life of Nevis.
I sort of remember Mrs. Nichols from Pinnis, just as you mentioned, using there as a meeting place. Did he try to ensure that there was a female on the board? Or that came just by the way of coincidental?
To be honest, I can't speak to that. It was good to have a woman. I cannot speak as to his motivation, as to he wanted to have a woman. All I can say, it was good to have a woman. And now that you've mentioned the board, I would like to mention the first board. The first directors of the bank were Richard Lupinacci, Tim Mosley, now deceased, Desmond Herbert, living in Leeds, Spencer Howell, Eustace Huggins, living in New York, Reginald Kawaja, living in Montreal, Canada, Catherine Nichols, now deceased, Carlton Paris, now deceased, Joseph Parry, current Premier of Nevis, Douglas Yearwood. And so that was the early board. You would notice a significant point here, though, that I didn't call Mr. Daniel's name. Mm-hmm. Mr. Daniel did a lot of the groundwork for the bank, but he was not a director. In other words, having chosen a team to take the bank forward, he did not insist that he had to be a director. As you know, he was premier at the time, but, you know, things do happen like this where people have several roles, and he opted not to be a director. He was legal counsel. His firm at the time was Daniel and Kawaja, and that firm, and Mr. Daniel was the one in Nevis, took care of the legal affairs, but he was not a director of the bank. And that is a tribute to him as well, that he didn't attempt to force himself on the bank to say, I must be in control or I must be a director. And he stood back and supported the bank and let the bank run with the people he had put in place. So I think he did a great job of simply putting a team in place and putting the institution in their hands. I would also say too, that in my opinion, Mr. Daniel has not had a huge financial benefit from the bank. He put in a lot of work. He served as legal advisor for a few years, but he was so busy with the political side of the development of Nevis that he soon gave that up. And so in my assessment, I don't have the exact figures, but he did not benefit financially. And that has to be said. That's a big tribute to the man, that he was satisfied. He wasn't in it for money.
And there's no question about it. 27 years on, the bank has been a great benefit to the people of Nevis. There's no doubting that it has improved the quality of life. Mm-hmm. Within the last year, they've moved into a spanking new building. And I imagine that in every aspect, you already spoke about the staff. Mm-hmm. From a financial standpoint, the bank must have grown significantly. How does it make you feel 27 years on?
Well, first let me just share some figures with you, since you mentioned the growth of the bank. I have some comparative figures here, and I'll mention them quickly. In March 1986, these were the figures. Deposits, $368,000. Loans, $231,000. Total assets, that is, all the assets added up, building, loans, everything, $866,000, not a million. In 1987, the figures had grown. Deposits, $3.2 million. Loans, $2.3 million. Total assets, $3.6 million. And by that time, the bank had run up losses of $308,000. Those are the worrying days, because nobody likes to see losses, especially if it's a bank. But for the first 5 years, the bank didn't make any profit. And we struggled to say when we're going to turn it around. But and in 1990, deposit $13.9 million. Loans $6.9 million. Total assets $15.4 million. And for the first time, the bank made a profit of $117,000. I'll mention three others. 91, $15.6 million in deposits. Loans $8.5 million. Total assets, $17 million, and profit of $197,000. 95, $27 million in deposits, loans, $19 million, total assets, $32 million, and profit, $544,000. Now, in 2011, the last financial report, annual report put out of the bank, the figures were as follows. Deposits, $338 million compared with $368,000 in 1986. Loans, and this is where that has been pumped into the Nevisian economy, in where houses, loans, etc., government even, $204 million. Total assets, $414 million. And profit, $6.7 million. So that comparative gives you an impression of the way the bank has grown in its numbers, has grown in its staff, has grown in its buildings and land. It has quite a sizable portion of land at the back. So the bank, it has not all been easy. I think we need to say that, because everybody, especially those who come along now, think it was always easy. It was not always easy. The bank had some difficult times in the early years, very difficult times. And I remember one particular time when the bank had to put a business in St. Kitts in receivership, a business called St. Kitts Apparel, a garment manufacturer, and we had invested in the business, maybe not too wisely, and soon after we invested, the business went belly up, left us with
hole in the bag.
And for years, we struggled to get something in the bag. But you know, when a business goes into receivership, it's not good news. Everybody runs left and right, but at the end, most times you get nothing. And those are troubling times for the bank. Because one of the assets of the bank, which is the building in St. Kitts, actually burnt while we were there trying to get some money. The fire started and wiped out. And we had problems also with the owners. It was a leased property. So the owners or the landlords were the St. Kitts government. And we had lots of issues. So it wasn't easy. And as I said, I can speak for myself, but I'm sure I can speak for others who are on the board. I don't want to mention names, but I'm sure I can speak for them. That for many years, we walked with a heavy worry on our hearts. That is true.
Yeah.
And that must be told.
Now, clearly you could speak on and on about the Bank of Nevis, having had such a long tenure, but we're striving to keep these interviews to about half an hour, and we'll come back to speak more expansively about this. Is it time, like Alexander Hamilton, that we have a dollar note with Daniel's image on it to memorialize him? Or can you think of other ways in which we should remember him?
In respect of a dollar, that is a decision not for the Nevisian public or the Nevisian government. That's a decision for the central bank and the whole OECS. But as you would know, they have put the images of other leaders on our dollar notes, and it will be a fitting point of respect for Mr. Daniel, but that is something I think we'll have to leave to others. But I do think that Mr. Daniel is the father of the Bank of Nevis, and as such he deserves every credit. So the credit is not for us who have come along after, who, as I said, the credit is really the first person to be mentioned always must be Mr. SIMEON DANIEL, who started the idea and who got everybody together and who pushed the idea. And we thought it was difficult or maybe not practical or it wouldn't work. He just kept the thing burning and went looking capital when everybody thought that this mightn't work. So he deserves a lot of credit. The bank has recently started a scholarship in the honor of Mr. Daniel. It's mentioned here in the annual report. And I'm sure as time goes on, he will be remembered for the great work he has done for the Bank of Nevis. I think he deserves a lot of credit, and he's the one. And now I would like to express my condolences to his family at his passing, and to let them know that he is fondly remembered, and he is remembered as a selfless person who worked tirelessly for something. He wasn't perfect, but I didn't see in him the motive of advancing self. I saw the motive. He always had Nevis at the forefront. That Nevis, Nevis, Nevis. That is how he must be remembered.
And could we end with a quote from Alexander Hamilton? Because I think it sums up very much the vehicle that the Bank of Nevis has been.
And Sim's vision. Yes, the quote from Alexander Hamilton. Famous Nevisian, first Secretary of the Treasury of the United States, and who was responsible for getting the American economy moving soon after independence. Most commercial nations have found it necessary to institute banks, and they have proved to be the happiest engines that ever were invented for advancing trade. And I think Sim was inspired by this quote by Alexander Hamilton and lived it with a passion.
Thank you very much, Hanzel, for sharing some thoughts with us. Of course, you hold the distinction, the singular distinction, of being the first chairman of the board of directors starting in 1985, and of course speaking so eloquently to the contribution made in the field of banking to the late Dr. SIMEON DANIEL. This has been another edition of Sim Remembered.
We'll open, seek, and you will find, ask, and you'll be given the key to this world of mine. I'll be waiting here with my arms unfurled, waiting just for you.